Okay, thank you, Juuso, very much for the introduction. Dear President, ladies and gentlemen, my professorship is in applied microeconomics, so I wanted to choose a topic that is both theoretically interesting and which has many important applications. So I want to talk about auctions. This will be a broad talk. I will speak quite broadly about auctions. Maybe if there is one takeaway that I wish you would take from here is that auctions have a lot to do with information. So let me start by putting auctions in the context of economic theory. So economics is about resource allocation, and resource allocation goes hand in hand with price formation. Traditionally, there is the traditional theory in economics about resource allocation and pricing is called general equilibrium theory. That was pioneered by Leon Walras in the 19th century and later in the 20th century by Arrow and DePruy and others modernized the theory. It's a very elegant theory about how prices are formed. It's basically demand and supply. Prices adjust in different markets in a way that that balance demand and supply. It's a very elegant theory, but it lacks two very important ingredients that we nowadays think that are very crucial in price formation. And those two things are strategic interaction and informational asymmetries. So it took two revolutions in economics to incorporate these two things into mainstream microeconomic theory. The first one is the game theory, which was developed, started by von Neumann and Morgenstern by their book in 1944, and later important results by John Nash and others. And then the other important insight developed a bit later at the end of the 70s was that asymmetric information is really important in economic interactions. And putting together games and informational asymmetries has given rise to a flourishing research in microeconomics. Nowadays, almost everything in microeconomics that is interesting has something to do with asymmetric information and interaction, strategic interaction between players. Ben Thompson's work is a good example of this big literature that was started from here, and he got his well-deserved Nobel Prize, as we all know, 2 days ago. But what I want to talk about here is a particular part of this theory that developed by combining these games and asymmetric information. It's about mechanism design. This is a theory about how institutions, trading institutions and also other institutions, how they should be designed and how they are designed in the real world, taking into account agents that have their selfish interests and private information. So probably it's about, the theory is called mechanism design, and auction is one particular institution, so auction theory is one part of this bigger literature about mechanism design. Here I just listed some of the people that are main contributors within the last decades. So let me now go a bit more into what auctions are about. So one way to see auction theory is that it is the modern version of theory about how prices are formed. So central questions in economics theory, how are prices formed? Also, what auctions can address is the question about how do prices aggregate dispersed information. This is something that the general equilibrium theory could say nothing about because it requires asymmetric information to ask this question. Besides being very important theoretically, auction theory is also a very powerful tool. It's a tool for market design. There are lots of important applications of auctions all around. When countries privatize public assets, they sell them through auctions. There are these big spectrum auctions in many countries where telecommunication spectrum rights are sold to telecommunication companies. Governments also buy things, and when they buy things, services from private sector, for example, they run procurement auctions. It's a buying auction, but it's just the same thing as selling something. Treasury auctions, when governments need to borrow, they sell bonds through treasury auctions. More broadly, all security exchanges can be seen as a form of auction. Then there are some important commodity markets that require very careful design for the markets, like electricity markets or emission permit markets. They are also auctions, or they operate through auctions. And then in the development of the internet has created large number of online marketplaces. Whenever you run a Google search, immediately there is an auction where the advertisers are going to bid for the right to send you an auction. It's happening all the time, in real time, all around the world. So auctions are all around, that's what I want to say. So what I want to do now is I want to give you some idea about what the auction research is and what are the main important issues about auctions. So let me, for this person, let me introduce the simplest model that I can think about auctions. So this would be a model of auctions. There is a single good that is sold through auctions, and there are n buyers. And each buyer has some valuation for this good. But it's random, it's different. Different buyers can have different values. So to model this situation, we might formulate the model in such a way that suppose that the values are random variables, say independently distributed from some uniform distribution, for example, to give the simplest case. But what is really important here is, and that's why we need auctions, is that these values are private information. I have my value for the good, but I don't have to tell it to anybody else. So only the bidders know their values. And then, for this model, the seller can pick from different alternatives, different possible auction formats. For example, first price auction. It's simply that every bidder places a bid. The winner is the one who has the highest bid, and he has to pay his own bid. Second price auction, just the same, except that the price paid is actually the second highest bid. And then there are this type of very typical in reality, where dynamic auctions where price rises from some low level until everybody except one has dropped out. Or you can start from a high price level and price descends until somebody decides to buy. There are different alternatives. And every auction format, that's a game. And when we want to understand what happens, we have to analyze it as a game. So let me spend a couple of minutes on this slide. So I want to show you how it works in the case of second price auction. That's the easiest to analyze. And it has a really remarkable property, actually. That if you are in a second price auction where you want to buy something, now we have to understand what the buyers are going to bid. This is where we need game theory. But in this second price auction, it's game theoretically very special case. It's actually the case that it's optimal for you to bid exactly your true value for the object. And why is this the case? Of course, you don't want to bid higher than your value because then you might have to pay more than what you value. But it's also not optimal to drop your price. By putting your price below your value, you might think that, okay, that's a way to get the object for cheaper. So maybe it's optimal to try to get it by at a cheaper price. But because the price is actually defined by somebody else's bid, I'm not going to affect the price that I have to pay by moving my price below my true value. So it is actually optimal, no matter what the other players do, it's optimal always to bid my own value. And that's very special in this auction format. So here in this figure, you can see one possible scenario what happens. There are two players, one has value V2, one has value V1. The price is defined by the second highest value, the difference between V2 and V1, that's the buyer's surplus that he gets. He doesn't have to pay what he actually values. And then the seller gets the rest, he gets the price as revenue. So there are two important properties of this solution. First, it's efficient, meaning that the object actually goes to the one that values it most. But the second important property is that the seller has to pay less than what he values, and this is the information rent that he gets. It's because he only knows himself what his true value is. He gets the object actually cheaper. Now you might say that, okay, it's just because we have second price auction. What about if you have first price auction? Then everybody has to pay their own bids. So wouldn't that be a way for the seller to actually take this information rent to himself? No, it wouldn't work, because of course if the bidders know that it's a first price auction, they don't want to bid their own value anymore, because then they really start to affect the price that they have to pay by bidding strategically below their own value. So when we change the auction format, the behavior of the agents change. And it will end up in a different situation. The price will be different now in first price auction than it was in the second price auction. The relevant question is, which one is better for the seller? What is an expectation will raise higher price? The surprising answer is that it's actually the same. And it's not only first price auction or second price, and it turns out that any auction format that is efficient in this situation leads to exactly the same expected revenue to the seller. This is the remarkable revenue equivalence theorem. It's like magic, I think, in this situation. But it doesn't work in other cases, just as an example of what theory can deliver, but it doesn't work always. So, but then there is still the question, is there some other way how the seller could get more than what he gets from this second price auction or first price auction? And yes, there turns out to be a good way to do it, and it turns out that the best way is to set the reserve price. The seller sets a reserve price and says that I'm not going to sell this at any bid that is slower than this V lower bar. There are two effects by setting a reserve price. First, buyers have to bid more aggressively. It will give higher prices on expectation. But then there is a downside. It's possible that all the bidders actually have valuation that is less than the reserve price, which means that there's no allocation at all. Nobody is going to buy the object. So it means that if we think about this auction as a mechanism that creates some surplus, some welfare, it's this pie on the left. On the left, the total pie is what the optimal, efficient auction, for example, first price or second price auction creates. It creates a pie which is shared between the seller and the buyer. Seller gets the yellow part and the buyer gets the red part. The reserve price will actually make the pie smaller, because there is going to be some welfare loss because some of the trade is not taking place that should take place. But the seller gets a much higher share. And that's what the seller might want to do. Okay, so this is just what auction design is all about. The size of the pie, that's the efficiency part, and then the sharing, splitting of the pie, how much the seller gets. It's a battle for this information rents, actually, and the seller would like to get as much of the buyer's information rents than possible. So there is always this tension between efficiency and revenue. Real life is, of course, much more complicated. There are lots of issues that make this situation more interesting to analyze, and that's why there is a big literature on auction market design, which tries to tackle this. All kinds of complications in real life that change this model to more complicated. But the key issue is this, the size of the pie and the division of the pie. Let me talk about a different connection between auctions and pricing, auctions and information. Imagine that I'm selling in auction this, a jar of coins. So what is different between this case and the previous model is that now this value of these coins is the same for everybody. It has some value, but it's the same for anybody. Anybody has the same financial value for these coins. But the problem is that people can have different opinions. Suppose that you only have visual inspection about this jar of money. So the question is, how much should you bid for this? So this is a situation where we have the winner's curse effect. If you would just bid what you expect at how much money there is, somebody will win who will have overestimated the value. So somebody will pay too much. So people have to take that into account. In other words, the very fact that you win in this kind of an auction gives some information to you about what others think about it. So the very fact you win brings information to you. And the same thing about the price, the realized price. Suppose some outsider sees this auction and sees only the market price. The price will put together the information or the views that the bidders have about the value of this object. And in this way, this price actually aggregates information that the bidders have. It's a stylized model of financial markets. Think about this jar of money as a stock of a publicly traded company. People have different opinions about the trade in the market, and somehow prices will take their information and put it in the price. This is what happens with common values auction. And it's, in reality, it's more complicated, of course, the auction, but this is what it's essentially about. And the question is, does this auction format aggregate information efficiently? In other words, if there is a large number of bidders, is the market price going to tell precisely what the actual value is? And this is an active research area still. The existing results are confirming, but there are some caveats. And this goes right to the argument that was made already by Hayek in 1945. There's a big debate at that time between the different economic systems, between centralized and decentralized market systems. And Hayek's main argument was that decentralized system is very good because prices are important carriers of information. So this type of auction models directly address this hypothesis or argument by Hayek, which he was not able to formalize at that time. Okay, so I think I have a couple of minutes. So let me just briefly give an example of my own work. So this is joint work with Juuso. So in standard auction theory, bidders are given as part of the model description. So we want to understand what happens in a common values environment when there is a large number of potential bidders, but they are not necessarily, they don't want to participate in the auction. So there is some cost of participation. So participation is part of the analysis. Who is going to participate in the auction? So the question is, who should participate and how does the choice of auction format affect who is going to participate? And the classical questions, which auction format maximizes sellers' revenue in this type of world and how is information aggregated? The questions that I already talked about more generally. And why we think it's interesting, first of all, participation costs are very realistic in many applications. And the second is that it turns around some very well-known results in the auction literature. So we think we got interesting, quite important results, and it's realistic. And we also plan to work on this in the future, so we plan to take this model framework that we have been working on to study this question about information aggregation in large markets. What does a small cost of participation do for the properties of information aggregation? And then we are going to think about the market model where there are actually many competing auctions. It's more a market model where the buyers choose which seller they approach. And we want to understand how these insights that we have from studying one auction, what kind of implications they have to the whole economy, or the larger market, which consists of many sellers. And we think it's relevant for example, frictions in labor markets and other that kind of market friction situations. So let me wrap up. Auction theory has been very successful for various reasons. First of all, it's one of very few situations in economics where the game format is very exactly defined. And that means also that it's very suitable for empirical testing. And data is available, and these are reasons why there is a huge literature on this. And of course, because there are plenty of important applications, people think that it's important. So one question is, has everything been done? The auction theory has been there already some decades, so it's not, auctions as itself is not a new thing. There is a big literature already. But I would like to argue forcefully that I think there are still some many gaps in our understanding about how auctions work. Moreover, there are new applications coming all the time. In this information age that we live, there are more new dynamic complex trading places, and the theory is still not, in many cases, not there yet. What we see in applications. There's computerized trading, rational agents, programmed to behave rationally. So I think this is an ideal field for game theoretic study, and these applications I think are also part of the reason why auctions are interesting for computer science people, also operations research people. And I'd like to end by noting that Aalto has strong units in all these fields, so I see auctions as one possible area where we could have very fruitful cooperation between these fields. Thank you very much for your attention.